U-shapes and D-shapes. The picture that seems like letter U versus D. An example of each one, looking straight ahead and seem to be off to your right. That's how the mountains come down from that D-shape, that's a D. And looking off to our left-hand side, you might notice that the mountains come down, bottom mountains come back up. And right where the river is, how it's really flat, that's what we call a U-shape. These are different because they're formed differently. Anytime you do see something in the shape of a D-shape, like off to your right, that is formed by moving liquid water, which are rivers, the rivers to your right. And then anything in the shape of a U-shape, like off to your left, is formed by moving frozen water, which are glaciers. You get glaciers left and rivers right. But if you look to your right-hand side, you might notice that there's almost an exact spot. It stops being a U-shape and then starts being a V-shape. And what that tells you is that that right there is exactly where a glacier came at its max. All the way to that point right there, stopped, and then it receded, and that carved out this entire valley. And so if you take that spot where it stops being a U-shape, starts being a V-shape, take it all the way back to the mountains, this right here. Something. So this is a little bit above eye level. Oh yeah, totally.
Well, there is one up there. I see it.
Ooh!
Yeah, there you go.
Okay. I see you up there too.
My best.
Yeah, I see you by the lake.
Where is it?
By the lake.
His eyes on the road.
Walking toward it. By that lake here.
Okay, I'm gonna turn this thing off. We're gonna hang out for at least 5 or 10 minutes here.
There it is.
Oh yeah. That's just ours. Oh, that's Holly's.
again, just to double check. It's coming through pretty, coming through pretty good on the screen. Yeah.
Just push the button.
Looks like squirrel. Like how he's like kind of jumping around.
It almost seems like she has a cub or something.
Yeah.
It looks like it got that something there, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
The one that's doing it.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
So I wanted to point out that the what I was just bringing up before we saw this was the huge hump on the back. So whenever it gets broadside again, take a look at that. I'll explain what that is. I'll explain that.
That sucks.
Yes. Yes.
He's coming this way. Yeah.
Yeah.
This
way. Yeah. Yeah. So we get the picture relief on the bottom.
So we'll do another like minute or two, and then we'll have to roll on. Turns head sideways, open its mouth, put its mouth at the very bottom of the berry bush, and then close its mouth, and then strip everything, all the leaves, all the berries, from the bottom to the top. And so right there, just one quick swipe, might be eating a dozen berries. And it's not going to be just like one swipe and then chew 50 times. No, it's going to be like 5, 6, 7, 10, 20, 50 chomps at a time. Each time maybe having a dozen berries, so right there in just a matter of moments, could be eating hundreds or thousands. And it's going to be like that pretty much nonstop, because after all, that is their last source of food that they know they're going to have going into the time, but they might not be able to eat for like 6, 7, 8, 9 months. Yeah, so 200,000 berries one day. Now, of course, they're hunters. I mean, they would hunt every single meal they could. And the only thing about that is, for one, there really isn't much to hunt. And two, they can compete with all the larger things. So what that means is that they have to go for the smaller things, things like moose calves, caribou calves, doll sheep lamb, but then also the much smaller things, things like the squirrels, the voles, the mice, you know, they're really little guys. In fact, if you were to get all those things together, squirrels, voles, mice, put them all together, well, the mass of all those small things put together is going to equal more than 4 times the mass of all the grizzly bears put together. So really, there's food here to sometimes come from some places that you might not be thinking about. I mean, they're not going to chase down a full-grown moose every single day. In fact, most bears will never even do that in their entire life. So think about the little things. One of those things that I'm starting to see every now and again is this little kind of like prairie dog looking thing that'll run in front of the bus, try to get run over. All right, well, it's actually not a prairie dog or a chipmunk, but it's called an Arctic ground squirrel. And whenever a bear sees a ground squirrel, it's going to think, oh man, that's an awesome 2,000 calorie snack. I could go for one of those. And then start chasing around. And now, of course, if you're getting chased around by a big bear, your little ground squirrel, you're probably going to be pretty scared and want to go home. That's exactly what a ground squirrel's thinking. They're going to find the nearest hole in the ground. They're going to dive into it, shut the door, close the blinds. And hopefully the bear didn't see it going there. But at the same time, that's exactly what a bear's going to want it to do. Because the bear's going to sniff out whichever hole that it think it went into, put its claws way out in front of it into the earth, use that hump on the back to pull the earth toward itself and maybe get lucky, and then dig up that 2,000 calorie snack. So I think that's what we were looking at back there, was watching it dig up squirrels. Yeah, so not only is that hump on the back a very useful tool for hunting, you know, digging up roots, but in the end is a, for hunting and digging up squirrels, but in the end is a lifeline for foraging, which a lot of which is digging up roots, and as you know now, that makes up more than these bears, 80% of their diet. So that hump on the back, that is the reason why the grizzly bear lives here, why the black bear does not.
Alright, so this right here is our turnaround. And where we are right now is the East Fork Cabin site. There's actually two structures over here, and the original one is the one that's furthest back. You can actually probably see it better from the road. And that's the original one. And as far as how they got out here, alright, well, so this place became a park in 1917 with the idea of protecting doll sheep from being overhunted. The park road construction didn't begin until 1922, and then didn't finish construction until the summer of 1938. So this took 17 summers to build 92 miles of road. And the way they did it is if, say they were starting at mile zero, there'd be a huge camp, you know, like a cabin, a bunch of tents, cookhouse, tons of people. And they would work on the road about 10 to 12 mile sections at a time. And so we've actually passed a couple of these cabins. So we passed the Savage Cabin first, Sanctuary Cabin, Igloo Cabin, and now we're here at East Fork. And whenever they would finish a certain section of the road, they would move the entire camp, all the tents, all the people. And so there was a camp right here, also for the park reconstruction. And at one point there also was a coal mine right behind us. It's actually called Coal Creek down below us. And every time that they would move a camp, they would leave a structure behind with the thought of doing patrols in the future, studies. And arguably the most historic study that was done anywhere in the park was done right here by two brothers named Adolf and Olaus Murie. That's M-U-R-I-E for the last name. And they pretty much wrote the book on wildlife. You know, one question that I get all the time is about tracking animals. Like people ask, like, do we collar stuff or chip stuff or GPS or whatever? And yeah, you know, there's a couple of different ways that we... Oh, yeah, there it is. It's pretty far out there.
That's cool.
Good find out.
Oh my god.
It's kind of like straight down from right between the two snow packs.
Between the two snow packs. Between the two packs.
Yeah, like
right
straight down.
Where there's straight down. Straight down.
There's like two hills and he's on like this side of the second one. Kind of in the little ravine.